Hi everyone, good evening. I'm Carolyn Torrey, and on behalf of the Aspen Words team, welcome to this conversation featuring Hampton Sides, our current writer in residence. For those of you joining us for the first time tonight, Aspen Words is a literary nonprofit and program of the Aspen Institute. Our mission is to encourage writers, inspire readers, and connect people through stories. Through the Writers in Residence program, we host authors and poets for a month-long residency in Woody Creek, Colorado, where they can disconnect from their usual routines and obligations and really dive deeply into a current project. The program would not be possible without the generous and longtime support of the Kato Shaw Foundation. Issa Kato Shaw and Daniel Shaw are just the dream partners and hosts for this program, and we're especially grateful to them this year for working with us under challenging circumstances brought on by the pandemic to make a safe and healthy residency possible this month. This is a special event because for the first time ever in the history of the program, our writer in residence is zooming in straight from the residency location, a beautiful cabin overlooking the Elk Mountains. And before I introduce Hampton, I just have a few quick event reminders and housekeeping notes. Hopefully, many of you have received the email invitation for Book Ball, our virtual benefit on October 29th, so coming up very soon. The event will feature cameos by some Aspen Words alumni authors, including some past writers in residence, as well as a short conversation with Cheryl Strayed, the author of Wild and host of the Sugar Calling podcast. You can access the event by making a gift of $100 or more to Aspen Words during the month of October. And our advisory board has generously agreed to match gifts up to $70,000 this month, so it's a great time to donate and make sure your gift goes twice as far. Your Book Ball donation helps support programs like this free author talk tonight, as well as writing workshops, youth scholarships, community book clubs, and more. A link with information and registration for Book Ball is included in the chat box on your screen, and we'll continue to use that feature throughout the hour-long talk to post a few other links. We've set aside the last 15 minutes of tonight's hour-long discussion for audience questions, and you can submit those anytime using the Q&A feature in the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. Thanks for your patience with those announcements, and now it's my pleasure to introduce our guest of honor. Hampton Sides is best known for his deeply researched works of nonfiction set in war or depicting epic expeditions and exploration. He's the author of the best-selling histories, Ghost Soldiers, Blood and Thunder, and The Kingdom of Ice, and most recently, On Desperate Ground. Hampton is editor-at-large for Outside and a frequent contributor to National Geographic, among other magazines. His journalism has been nominated for National Magazine Awards, and he serves on the board of the Society of American Historians and the Authors Guild. He lives in Santa Fe, New Mexico. He'll be in conversation tonight with Ellie Scott from the Aspen Words team, a talented writer and editor whose wanderlust and love for history and adventure makes her a big fan of Hampton Sides' work and the perfect moderator for tonight's talk. Thank you both. And with that, I will turn it over to you, Ellie.
Okay. Thank you, Carolyn. Thanks so much. And thank you, Hampton, for joining us tonight. I wish we were in a cozy craft cocktail bar, which is where we normally host the writer in residence talks. But I'm still glad that you're here with us, and I'm honored to have the chance to speak with you tonight. I've been a fan of your work for a long time, so welcome.
Good to hear that. Good to be here. And I got a little cocktail of my own, full disclosure, but really a pleasure to be here, at least virtually, with all of you. And thanks for organizing this whole thing.
Absolutely. Well, let's dive into your work. This hour is going to fly. So you've written so many incredible books, and you've written on topics, everything from Kit Carson and the American West to Arctic exploration and shipwreck to the epic stories of military heroism and courage. I'd love to delve deeply into each one of your books, but that would require an hour at least for each one. So we can't do that, but I do hope to our conversation will weave together some of the elements and themes across your subject matter. So I just wondered if we could start off sort of, if you could give everyone a sense of your work and just maybe sum up in a few sentences the scope of what you write about and tell us what draws you to your topics and your subjects?
Okay. It seems like the kind of books that I've been doing, at least so far, have been described as sort of like macho tales of woe, expeditions that go awry, stories with really bad diet, you know, bad hygiene, stories about men, and it seems to be mostly men, in extreme situations, fighting the elements, fighting each other, and if it's a story about war. And the theme that emerges, I guess, in most of my books is this question of what combination of traits are people able to summon in these extreme situations that get them to the other side, you know, get them through an ordeal, whether it's an ordeal of geography or weather or a warfare, or some other trials or tribulations. So that seems to be a theme that I guess I picked up when I was an editor for a good while at Outside Magazine, down in Santa Fe, where I live. That's what brought me to Santa Fe. You know, we were constantly doing stories like this about people in, you know, Alpine scenarios or survival situations that, you know, anything you could imagine. And I think I kind of took that theme and started applying it to historical situations when I became a writer of histories. And so I'm constantly looking for those kinds of stories that pit men or women, I don't really care, but so far most of my stories have tended to be men in these situations, against the elements, against these different environments where you have to, you have to summon whatever it's a sense of faith in yourself, a sense of faith in God, faith in your own ability to get through this situation. Sometimes it's a sense of humor to survive these situations. Whatever it is, I'm interested in that theme of, and also kind of running parallel with that is, I can't help but as a writer ask myself how I would fare in these situations, and how I think that's what part of the attraction to readers is, like readers ask the same question: how would I get through that ordeal, or would I fold up my tents and give up? And you know, whether it's a story in the Arctic or a story in warfare, so forth. So I think that's part of it. I'm also interested in different time periods. I think a lot of people have said to me, well, why don't you just keep writing about World War II? My first book was Ghost Soldiers, about a prison of war camp in the Philippines in World War II. And why don't you keep writing World War II stories now that you've gotten that kind of under your wing? And, you know, I think it's that I need to keep moving around different time periods. I think I have a little bit of a sense of historical ADD. I just get tired of one era, one piece of geography, one set of characters, and want to move drastically, you know, onto something very different. Those are the things that kind of unite my books. But having said that, I think they're very different. They're very eclectic. Right now I'm working on a book about the third and final voyage, and I know we're going to get to that a little bit later. The third and final voyage of Captain James Cook, the British navigator who sailed all over the world, and particularly the South Seas and also up in Alaska. So I move around. I don't know. I think I get bored with doing the same thing over and over again. It'd be much smarter and much easier if I just picked one period and became an expert in that, but I'm not that kind of person.
Yeah, and frankly, I don't know that you would have as wide of an appeal. I think you're a beloved writer because you can write specifically, about these human stories that happen across generations, across geographies. You can sort of follow your curiosity, which probably offers you a wider readership in some ways, because we're all curious about things that maybe we don't even know that we're curious about until you illuminate something for us. So, but that said, I wanted to sort of go back to what you mentioned in the middle of that, when we were talking about the themes that you do sort of illuminate, like exploration and survival and endurance. Even though the stories you write are just these epic stories of of grand proportion, where a lot of us think, you know, most of us have never ever dealt with anything even remotely on that scale. And yet, because you tell the human stories, you almost offer your reader like this sense that what would they do in that situation? And I really liked how you phrased that. I just wonder how, like what draws you to the topics and the subjects, but also if these core values are sort of values that define you personally, and what can we take away from the enormous stories and apply them to our own lives? Because we all survive in our own ways, right? We're all surviving a pandemic right now. I didn't have to endure the Bataan Death March to know that it's survival happens for all of us. And so I just wonder if you could sort of extrapolate that, talk about these core values and themes, but how people, you know, whether you think that your reader can apply them to their own lives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I mean, having, you know, these people I write about and these situations I write about, I do realize that I am a complete wimp. I mean, there's just no way I would have survived with the grace under pressure that these men of the Bataan Death March, for example, survived. Maybe that's really what draws me so much to these stories, is that I just don't think I have. I think our generation generally, and your generation, I'm not sure we have that fiber and that backbone that some of these guys had, and particularly true of the Arctic explorers who went through hell and back to get to these godforsaken places in the name of exploration. So I don't in any way, you know, write these books with the sense that I have what these men have, or, you know, I keep saying men. It seems to be mostly these books so far I've written talk about men in these situations. And when I go to book festivals, you know, by far the majority of the books that are bought and sold and read are books about women and read by women. And what happens is I'm usually the fifth guy on, you know, the panel, the fifth person on the panel who's like, oh yeah, we have to have a guy writer who writes about masculine stories, so that, you know, it's like eventually my publisher figured out who my readership was. And it is women who buy masculine sounding books for their husbands and their sons and their brothers for Father's Day, for the birthdays, and for Christmas. That's exactly, you know, and here's the weird part of that, is that they buy these books for their men and their lives, and then they read them more than the men do, because men don't even read the books that are given to them as gifts. So thank God for women. And many people have asked me many times, like, why don't you find a great biography of a really strong and powerful, you know, woman character to write about? And I am on the hunt for that. And, you know, I don't want you to think I just have such a narrow bandwidth that I only want to write about men. But so far it has been largely male stories, I guess. And I guess there is something I'm interested about was when men get together in these situations, the dynamics that play out, leadership, so often there's mutiny or suggestions of mutiny. Men have all kinds of bad wiring. And, you know, I don't know that they cooperate so well in these expeditions, but often they do. And it's great when it all works. So I am interested, you know, as a man, and I guess how men function as a group, you know, in an ensemble story, like an expedition across the Arctic, for example. It is an interesting theme to explore. Anyway, and I'm, you know, just generally speaking, I'm particularly drawn to stories that I think are both classic, durable, and were important in their day, but are somehow have become forgotten or largely forgotten. Then I think a historian every now and then, every subsequent generations needs to try to resuscitate these stories and find new life, breathe new life into them. That's always great when you can find a story that was kind of important in its time, consequential in its time, but fell through the cracks. You know, it's really cool when you can do that. And that's one role that I think a historian, you know, can do, rather than just writing yet another book about Lincoln or yet another book about the Civil War. big battle, find, isolate some, a little more obscure story from the interstices of history and bring it up to the fore. That's a really cool thing when you can do that.
Yeah, absolutely. And just to go back to what you were saying about you write only stories about men, I mean, maybe that's generally true, but you do actually offer multiple viewpoints, and there are female characters in your story that you, I feel like, do try and do your due diligence and research their viewpoints. So I don't want the listener to get a total wrong idea that you're just like a completely macho guy, because you also really, you investigate the emotional landscapes of the characters, which is not a typically like male macho writerly thing to do, but you do it very well. And I also wanted to just back up to where you were saying women buy the stories for their husbands. And that's exactly how I came to know your work, because my mother bought my father Blood and Thunder when I was like in grade school, I think. So that's how and he loved that book so much that you became kind of a household name. And then, you know, I think I just always got my dad a Hampton Sides book for any gift. So that, I think that is definitely very true. But he's certainly a male writer that loves your work as well. And I wanted to pivot just a little bit to, though your books are not set in one common time period, they're all really, really timely. They all seem very surprisingly timely. Like they're steeped in this controversial tension that continues to play out in our contemporary society. And I'm thinking right now about your most recent book, On Desperate Ground, which illuminates the biggest conflict of the Korean War at the Chosin Reservoir. And its characters have personalities that seem to mimic sort of the certain personalities of current political figures that might come to mind. And it also provides some context for the convergence of the Russian, American, and Chinese presence on the Korean Peninsula. And so it still has this total relevance for today. But I feel like all of your books have this modern day resonance, even if you've been writing about something that took place 100 years ago or 200 years ago. And so I just wondered if you could speak to the universality of that and what's like, tell us why these stories feel like they might, could still be happening today. What is that about history?
Well, I think part of that is deliberate on my part. I am looking for the live wires in a historical subject, like what's unfinished business, what's still current, what's still controversial, and I try to exploit it. Some historians I think try to avoid controversy, and I'm looking for controversy. I think it's what makes a work of history seem relevant to modern day readers. So part of that is deliberate, and part of it is accidental. I mean, I pick a story, and then it doesn't come out. It is not actually published for sometimes 5 years. So I can't tell you that I was so clairvoyant as to know that North Korea would be in the news as much as it was when On Desperate Ground came out. Part of it is that you just pick a story that interests you and you hope that you can find the relevance later. But it's really great when the news, brings out a story and in high relief and makes it seem more and more, relevant to readers. So, and I think that's really important because, I mean, fewer and fewer people are reading history and buying history. Fewer and fewer people are majoring in history in college. So part of the reason is because it just seems stale and mildewy and old fashioned. But whenever you can find, this is a story that really speaks to the current times, it's just much more, there's just a lot more magnetism around it. So I guess even just in choosing my topics, I am trying to find a relevance to today, right? I think maybe all historians do that, but I've had a few of late that are, like the one I'm working on now, Captain Cook. Captain Cook is, he's everywhere you go in Polynesia and the South Seas. His obelisks and his statues are coming down. He's hated as this great, first wave of colonialism. He is considered you know, Ollie was considered one of the greatest, if not the greatest navigators of all time. And now he's considered this first wave of genocide. And, you know, Kit Carson, the subject of my book, Blood and Thunder, is also one of these controversial, but also in for those direct reasons, very contemporary character. There was an obelisk in the Plaza of Santa Fe, where I live, dedicated to Carson's times and to the wars that he fought, that just was pulled down 2 days ago, just yanked down by a bunch of protesters. All that controversy, I just, you know, I think it's great for my books, because it definitely makes you realize that history is never over. It's never done. These threads and these themes are still very much alive in current times. And that's why you should read history.
Yeah, absolutely. And that actually, I mean, we might as well pivot to talk about your current work, your current project here at the Cato Shaw Residency, because that is a big section of what I wanted to speak with you about. You're writing about Captain Cook. And like you said, Kit Carson is he was once considered a sort of a friend to the native population, a translator. He spoke multiple languages. He traded with them in some sort of equitable ways, and yet also was capable of executing horrible orders that were very, very detrimental to the Navajo people. And so I just wonder what that's like for you as a writer to really, illuminate the luminous qualities of these people, who they were, but also not shy away from their very problematic acts that they committed. And so, has writing about Captain Cook during this time, has it informed your awareness anymore of our contemporary struggles with imperialism and at our deep roots of colonial injustice? I mean, has it shaped your thinking at all, or are you approaching it that way?
Yeah, sure. I mean, again, all of this controversy that's, we've been talking about pulling down monuments in the South and Confederate generals and slaveholders, and here in the Southwest, pulling down monuments about the conquistadors. And similarly, that's been happening all across the South Pacific. A reappraisal, a reset of the historical understanding of who these people were. So all of that is, at first I maybe thought, well, this isn't good for my book in some way, but then I began to embrace it and realize it's great for my book, because this is, again, what makes it contemporary and current is, and so I try to see Cook from the Polynesian point of view, for example. And I try to, but at the same time, understand his great qualities. I mean, for his times, he was quite enlightened, and he was quite objective in his, and very just genuinely curious about the peoples that he encountered. He was also a brilliant navigator and a brilliant commander. But on this third voyage, there was something wrong. Something was going wrong with Captain Cook. And that's one of the things that historians have been trying to figure out, whether there was something physically wrong with him or mentally wrong with him. He started like flogging his own men and, reacting in this really sadistic ways towards theft that he encountered in French Polynesia, what we now call French Polynesia, whipping, flogging, and literally severing ears of thieves. And it got more and more brutal as he worked his way up to Hawaii. And of course, Hawaii, he didn't discover Hawaii. The Polynesians discovered Hawaii, but he was the first European to discover Hawaii. And things did not go well for Captain Cook in Hawaii. As you probably know, he ultimately was, they thought he was a god at first of some sort, or a representation, a manifestation of a god. And then they decided he wasn't a god. And then they surrounded him on the beach in the big island of Hawaii and killed him and baked him and ultimately possibly ate him. So this is maybe a story of a different sort, where the Polynesians got the upper hand in terms of this white man entitlement story. And we may have recipes in the back. just kind of a cookbook in the back But seriously, and you know, I haven't gotten to that part of the story, so I don't want to prejudge how I'm going to write about it, but I think perhaps he deserved it in some weird karmic way. I'm not invested in Cook's legacy, or, you know, I'm not, you know, it's not like that at all. I try to be as objective in my analysis of what he did right, and what he did in the end, what he did wrong. But I'm also, this is really an ensemble story. This is a story of the expedition. There were there were about 200 men on this expedition in two ships, the Resolution and the another ship called the Discovery. And they sailed all over the world and had unbelievable experiences and adventures. And I'm interested in the dynamics between all these men and how they got along and when they didn't get along. And just that last days of what we now would call the age of pure discovery. Like, you just venture out into this ocean and you don't know what you're going to find. And, you know, they didn't know they were going to find Hawaii. They didn't know, they thought they were going to go sail over the top of Canada, Alaska and Canada, and find a Northwest Passage. Well, they didn't find that, but they, in the process, they mapped the entire coast of Alaska and did all these other amazing things. So it's both an adventure story and ultimately a story of these first encounters of different peoples all across the Pacific Ocean. So it's a great adventure story, and just I've had a ball doing it. And working here in Aspen on a really critical chapter that has to do with, I don't want to get too in the weeds here, but there was a Polynesian man who came to London on Cook's second voyage back to London, lived for 2 years in London, was paraded around England as a kind of a curiosity, kind of like a dancing bear, you know, like just like, look at all the tricks he can do. But he ended up taking London by storm. He was just this beloved character who became, you know, he dated all these society ladies, and he learned English, and he learned to play chess and backgammon, and was a great hunter in the estates out in the countryside. And, you know, he got one of the very first smallpox vaccinations because people knew that natives from different indigenous populations were susceptible to smallpox. You know, this is way back in the 1770s. He was the very first Polynesian to come to England. And so I'm writing about him now here in Aspen. That's the chapter that I'm working on now. His name was Mai. M-A-I, Mai, and just an extraordinary person. And then on the third voyage, he was brought back to Polynesia with all these English clothes and English belongings, and they built him an English-style house in Polynesia and gave him guns and gunpowder and, you know, a suit of armor and horses, which had never been seen before in these islands, and left him there to fend for himself. And so I tell the kind of tragic, or at least bittersweet, story of Mai, and that's what I'm working on here for the residency.
That's so fascinating. Okay, so that's the chapter you're working on now. Yeah. How has the residency been going? You got here about 2 weeks ago. Do you feel like you're able to sort of sink into it, to the work? How's it been going for you?
It's great. I mean, okay. So a big shout out to the hosts of this residency, Issa and Daniel Shaw. They are just amazing people and wonderful hosts, and they're two amazing dogs who come over and visit. And I can't exaggerate how important it is, I think, for writers, at least like me, to have a change of venue and just unplug from the world I know, and, you know, just think about my books and, you know, think about my writing. And so that's been great. But I've also, some supporters of the program have reached out to me. They found out I was in town. I was just over for a dinner last night with some big supporters of the program, Kara and Robert Barnes. Big shout out to them. Great dinner last night. Not too many of those, or I won't write the book, but you know, it's just a really cool thing to do. And I'm really honored to be you know, to be part of this program. I've had some friends who've done it over the years and who have just spoken, you know, so highly of the, it's both the, you know, the, they leave you alone. But if you want social contact, you know, with now with a little bit of social distancing, you can have that too, which is, you know, which is great. It's a perfect balance. So nothing but good things to say about it.
That's awesome. Yeah. We are also super grateful to the Cato Shaw Foundation. We love this program and we're so glad that even though most of the residency was canceled, we're glad that it finally,
yeah,
we were able to make safely host you. I also want to echo the shout out to Issa and Daniel. And I'm glad that it's been productive for you. I know that this is like, what a strange time to be writing. I think the pandemic has either, if you're a writer, it's either made, you know, just sort of like, this is perfect for you, or it's just been so all consuming that it you can't think straight. And so I'm wondering how the pandemic has treated you in terms of your writing. And I mean, the residency is sort of designed for pandemic life in a way, but just even before the residency, how have you been doing?
Well, I was traveling through and sailing around, break out the violins here, French Polynesia with my wife and some friends, going to all these islands where Cook went and where Mai lived when the COVID madness hit the world. And, we weren't in touch with the news there for a number of days, and it gradually dawned on us, oh, this is serious and this is changing everything. There was a moment there where we didn't think we could even get back to the United States. And we thought, well, this is great. We'll just stay here forever in paradise. But we, you know, we did get back, obviously, and we, in a weird way, the pandemic is perfect for what I do because it forces me just to do what I need to be doing anyway, which is sitting down and writing. That's what writers do. They're already quarantining if they're doing their job. However, I wasn't finished with my research by any stretch. And so what it's forced me to do is something I've never done it before. It's like, write with what you got, you know, just go with what you got, get it down on the page, and then go back later, hopefully, after this is all over, and fill in the gaps. So I have a lot of travel that I want to do, hopefully in 2021, to fill in the gaps along the way. But I've turned in more than half the book based on just what I have. And it's been an interesting way to do it, kind of reverse engineering or something. I've turned in about 300 or 400 manuscript pages. And, but I really am the kind of writer who wants to physically go to these places that I'm writing about. I just don't feel comfortable writing about this landscape. And landscape is really important in all my books, unless I've seen it. And if there's any way of seeing it, I want to see it. So, and I also need to spend a lot of time in England where all these documents are. I've read digital versions of all the documents, but I want to hold them and smell them and feel them and, you know, go to where Cook was born and go to where all these other characters lived and died and so forth. So I'm kind of doing it ass backwards, you know, like, you know, write it and then go and do some of the research and fill in the holes a little later. That's my strategy.
Well, that was actually a question that I had for you is, do you go to the places that you're researching, and is that an essential piece? And it sounds like it is. Have you gone to Antarctica, to the Arctic, not Antarctica, but to the Arctic where the USS Jeanette set sail for the North Pole? I mean, have you been to everywhere that you've written about? Cause that's massive. Well,
no, there's no way, but but within the law, within the boundaries of finances and deadlines, I try to go to these places and in the Kingdom of Ice, my book about the Arctic, I really want to go to the Arctic. I want to go to the Russian, you know, the Siberian Arctic where this story mainly unfolded. And it took a lot of time and energy and money to figure out how to kind of follow in the Jeanette's footsteps, but I did. And it made the book. I mean, it really did, like, to the extent that the book was any kind of success, or the passages that I think are the most meaningful and are the result of having gone there and smelled and felt what it's like you know, 400 miles north of the Arctic Circle in these Siberian islands. It's so important. And I know that you can write without going to these places. There are a lot of historians who crank out books and are able to do it without much travel. But I mean, I what's the point? The fun is in the travel. And it gives you a confidence when you're writing those particular passages that have to do with that particular landscape that, you know, I would feel like a phony if I tried to write without having gone there. So whenever possible, yes. Now, the most recent book that I did, On Desperate Ground, is about a battle that happened in North Korea. And I made every attempt possible to get to this battlefield. And I couldn't get there. I could get to North Korea. I could get to Pyongyang, the capital of North Korea, but the battlefield is in a sensitive area and there was just no way. So it gave me, it was the first time I've ever written about a topic where I couldn't get there. It drove me insane. It really drove me crazy. I could look at Google Earth. I could look at topographical maps. I could go to South Korea. I could into those same mountain, that same mountain range. I could get right up to the 38th parallel. I could look at photos. I could look at video, well, not video, films that were taken. I could triangulate all this information, but I couldn't actually go. And it kind of drove me a little bit crazy not to walk that battlefield. But in that case, it just wasn't going to happen.
So. Sure. No, I mean, that makes sense. And it also makes sense because place is such an important factor in all of your work. It is, you know, it is very cinematic the way you describe place, and it is almost like a character or a presence all its own in a lot of your work. And so, you know, the way you capture place and the way you capture characters and their personal stories, it seems really effortless when you read it. It just seems like you're just a masterful storyteller. But
keep going.
But I imagine that took a lot of work to get to sort of understand that timing. And so I'm wondering, when did you consider yourself, like, when did you become a writer? When do you remember what the first thing you wrote was? Like, how did you start out as a writer, and what has your journey been like?
Well, I grew up in Memphis and Memphis, Tennessee, and there's some really great writers who grew up, who lived in that part of the world, including Faulkner, who I will never compare myself to. But one guy that I did meet early on growing up was this historian, a narrative historian, Shelby Foote. He was a great Civil War historian. His son was a friend of mine. And, you know, as I started growing up and started realizing that I was interested in writing, I did a series of interviews with him and realized that, you know, here was a prime example of someone who can, you know, has made his whole life career focused on the idea that history isn't boring. History needs to read like a novel. Mm-hmm. History needs to focus on all those qualities that make great fiction work, like character and landscape and conflict and controversy and, you know, all those human aspects. And you know, he was the star of the Ken Burns documentary, you know, PBS documentary on the Civil War. And so I guess, in a weird way, even though I didn't realize it at the time, he was a big influence on my career as a writer. I really thought I would be a journalist. Mm-hmm. My mother literally bought me a trench coat, a London Fog trench coat. I wanted to be a Woodward and Bernstein kind of Washington journalist and, you know, investigative reporter. I did, in fact, after college, move to Washington. And although I had majored in history, I went to Yale and majored in history, but I wanted to be a journalist. I wanted to have scoops and, you know, exposés and, you know, bring down presidents and, you know, do all kinds of sexy things. But I started to realize I wasn't good at that. I wasn't good at political journalism. I wasn't good at kind of investigative reporting. I wanted to leave Washington. I was interested in America. I was interested in sort of in the idea of America, like what makes this country tick and all these different groups and, you know, this massive landmass, like how does it hold together? And so I traveled all over the country and I did a couple of books that were kind of travel log books. And eventually my wife and I moved to Santa Fe and we fell in love with it. And after leaving Outside Magazine, I started writing these books that were, I guess, you know, I didn't really think of myself as a historian. I thought of myself as a journalist who does history, you know, it's a slight difference. I'm not an academic. I don't have a PhD. I think that ultimately was to my credit because I don't write like an academic, but I think that ultimately it's about, you know, finding stories that have great characters. I think that's the big difference between narrative history and academic history is character. In developing characters, showing them over the arc of an entire, you know, big story and how they change, how they evolve, trying to make it readable. That's the other part. I really want people to actually read it, buy it first. That's the most important part. And then read it and they really turn the pages and care about these characters and become emotionally invested in them. I think that's what good narrative history can do. And that's exactly what Shelby Foote, all those years ago, I think taught me through osmosis, it should be readable. It should be interesting. It should be entertaining. In addition to being obviously informative. That's kind of the background of my writing and how I came to it.
Yeah, that's fascinating. And also, I just want to echo what you said to our listeners, whether you're tuning in live or if you're going to catch this recording later, but buy the books. I meant to mention this at the beginning, but we did post some links in our chat where you can buy all of Hampton Sides' books from Explore Booksellers. They're our local bookselling partner here in Aspen. So if you're local, you can buy it through their website or you can call them and pick it up on the porch there. Or if you're not local, you can buy it through the book, our bookshop.org page, which also supports Explore Booksellers. And there it's linked to all of Hampton's books. So they are incredibly readable. As you say, they focus on character. It keeps the readers turning pages. They're cinematic. They read like novels. So even if you don't consider yourself a history buff, you will enjoy these books. So a pitch for Explore and a pitch for Hampton Sides. buy the books. But going back to your research, Hampton, I just wanted to know what sources you find most valuable. I know obviously you can't have firsthand sources with some of your stories, but with certain other ones that have happened more recently, you can talk to folks. So I think you actually spoke to some folks for On Desperate Ground, but I'm wondering what you find the most helpful. Is it always best to have a firsthand narrative or letters and journals and secondhand articles? Are they more useful to you? What's your experience with those sources?
Yeah, first a big shout out, yes, again, to Explore Books and to all the great independent bookstores who are really struggling right now with the pandemic. They were struggling already, but now they're really struggling, but they're such important assets to their communities. We have a great bookstore in Santa Fe, Collected Works, and Explore Books is a great place. I've done a bunch of signings over the years there. So thank you. There's no substitute for getting a document or if it's an interview, from someone who was there, you know, who lived and breathed and smelled and tasted the, you know, what it was like to be alive in that moment. And that's big problem with, you know, a lot of book ideas that I come across where I go, you know, this is a great idea, but there's not enough of that firsthand primary material. So it's like, that's the well that you have to keep going to describe, to get you through the narrative, you know, like, this cook story that I'm writing, there were 200 some odd people on board and about 30 of them wrote extensively about what they were seeing and what they were smelling and, you know, what was going on. And so you can triangulate all this, all these amazing, there's Zimmerman and Ledyard and Samwell. And, you know, I'm like, you know, it's like, you can compare and contrast all these different accounts in addition to Cook's version. And that's the mother load for me, when you can get a multitude, almost too much information from primary sources. You can then filter that through the secondary and tertiary source material, historians who've written about these people, biographers. But yeah, and letters, obviously, and diaries, journals, all that stuff's great. So that's what you're really looking for. If it's a more recent story, as you alluded to, then interviews, you know, and that's what I used to do for 25 years. I was a journalist and I'm pretty good at interviewing people. There's an art to interviewing, you know, it's kind of a mutual audition where you're checking each other out, and then you figure out a way to get them to trust you. And hopefully it's a genuine thing where they just trust you. But sometimes it's more like they just really desperately need to tell their story to someone. I love interviewing people. And when it's a more recent story, you can do that. That's great. When it's a more distant story, deep in the past, you have to rely more and more on documents, which is interesting and has its own challenges, but it's also easier in some senses because they can't talk back to you. They can't tell you you're wrong. But it's scary because you don't have that lifeline. You can't pick up the telephone and fact check everything. You have to rely on a lot of murkiness that's in the documents. Then you superimpose upon that travel and going to the places and hopefully bringing in the oral history of the Polynesian perspective, or like in Kit Carson and the Blood and Thunder, bringing in like the Navajo oral histories, and you just bring in as many other layers as you can to make the narrative show multiple points of view. So. Mm-hmm. But there's no substitute for the primary stuff. That's what you're really looking for.
Mm-hmm, for sure. Yeah. For the books that you can't have primary sources, I'm wondering if you ever have the experience, I know I've heard fiction writers describe this kind of mysterious moment where they're writing a character and suddenly the character takes over and starts writing themselves. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know if that would happen with narrative nonfiction, or can you not, I mean, are you allowed to let yourself be turned over to some other thing to write through you? Or do you feel really kind of bound by what you are working with, which is the documents and so forth? I mean, does that magic ever happen while writing narrative nonfiction, that mystery?
Maybe, I mean, in the sense that, okay, like, you know, it's a big no-no to jump inside the head of a character and sort of tell the reader what you think they were thinking or feeling in a moment. It's something that I made the mistake of doing in one of my earlier books, and like I learned the hard way, do not do that. You know, that's what historical fiction is about. There's no problem. You just a couple of clicks on the dial over here and you can get into historical fiction, which is a perfectly legitimate and venerable genre. And you can start jumping inside the heads of your characters and attributing dialogue, making up dialogue. And with nonfiction, you just can't do that. You just can't do it. You can make it feel like fiction. You can make it feel like it's reading in the pacing and other tricks and so forth, but you can't make stuff up. And that said, there's no question there are characters that you feel like as you dig deeper and deeper and deeper into them, into their writings, into their accomplishments, that you feel like you know them. You feel like, and you start dreaming about them. You start, you know, inhabiting their world, and they do kind of take over the narrative. Kit Carson was one of them. I didn't have any intention of writing so much about Kit Carson. I was just going to write about the Navajo Wars. And I had to ask the question, well, who is this guy, Kit Carson? Why is he so famous, like, you know, and next thing you know, I'm writing, I expanded the book by 30 years and many, many thousands of geographical miles, because I wanted to explain who Kit Carson was and why he mattered to the bigger story of the American West. And even though he was illiterate and therefore didn't, you know, he didn't write anything, he dictated some things, but he comes through, I think, loud and clear through the book, his voice and his vision, good, bad, and ugly. And so, yeah, that was a case where a character hijacked and upstaged the book that I had originally intended to write. There's a, in The Kingdom of Ice, it's primarily about the captain of the ship, a guy named DeLong, but there's this other character named Melville who just takes over the narrative because he wrote better, I guess, and he wrote a big book, and he was this larger than life character who went on to become the chief engineer of the United States Navy. And, you know, he just, you know, I didn't see it coming. He just, so sometimes you have to step back and just let the characters fend for themselves and figure out who's the boss. And Melville became the boss in that particular case. So there so I guess a variation of what you're talking about does happen, but you know, you still can't invent dialogue, you can't invent thoughts, and you can't invent feelings.
Makes total sense. Yeah, I just was curious if you would kind of be confined, or if you would be able to go with that flow, but it makes sense. I think we are coming down to time, so I want to make sure we give some audience members a chance to ask some questions. Yeah. And some have been rolling in. If you would like to ask a question, feel free to use the Q&A feature in the bottom of the Zoom screen. But there are actually a couple that I see that were questions that I still had. So one question is, let's see, from an anonymous person, has one of your books been significantly tougher to write than others? And if so, why? That was a question that I also wanted to ask. I imagine war books are harder on the psyche than adventure books.
Yeah, well, that's actually the first thing I was gonna say is yes. There's something about, like, On Desperate Ground and also Ghost Soldiers, which was my first history. They're both war stories, and you know, the stakes are higher, and there's just so much violence, and there's so much tragedy associated with war, both the immediate tragedy of warfare, but you know, what it does to the people who live there, and kind of the ramifications that kind of emerge from war, and it's you kind of marinate in that for 2-3 years. It affects you. It affects your dreams. It affects your outlook on life. And so yeah, I think, and also there's another element of military stories, which is this kind of it's so hard to figure out what's happening on the ground because there's so many different points of view. Two people who are 20 yards away from each other may have a completely different experience, and yet they're telling you exactly what happened, and you have to figure out a way to reconcile these different seeming contradictions or timeline discrepancies. War does weird things to the memory, to your memory, and you exaggerate certain things. If you're, especially, you know, the people who are on the front lines fighting in the battle, and your adrenaline's pumping, and you know, it's like it gives you an aneurysm almost, just trying to sort through like all these stories and how do they fit together. And wait a minute, this was 1 hour later than what you'd said before, and you know, you're just constantly running down little facts that mm-hmm. that are actually important facts to the story, and it drives you crazy, honestly. And so I have a renewed respect for people who are professional military historians. Mm-hmm. Is really hard. You know, like if there's an accident, car accident, you know, and the people sit around talking afterwards, like what they saw, the witnesses, and mm-hmm. There's a million different discrepancies. Well, expand that by, you know, exponentially on a battlefield. And that's kind of what you're dealing with when you're trying to write military history. Apart from the horror and the bloodshed and the tragedy is just figuring out how to tell the story accurately as you can. Yeah. Exploration stories, which is sort of my other big theme, I guess, are much more gratifying. I mean, there's just something about venturing out into the world and going on a voyage and not knowing what's going to happen. And, you know, it's just, there's a classic structure to it. You know, they leave and then, you know, they go out into the world and things happen. And then finally they return. You know, it's a much more satisfying and gratifying process trying to capture that. And, you know, they become friends, there's enemies, you know, there's fights, there's duels, there's maybe a little bit of mutiny, you know, there's always the three classics: mutiny, scurvy, and cannibalism. Good times. But that said, there is some kind of something joyous and wonderful, and there's a certain splendor to pure exploration, which is something almost not even available to us now, like unless we go into outer space. That is true about these stories. When they were leaving, in the case of the Cook voyage, they left in July of 1776, just as the revolution in the colonies was starting to happen. These men left England to go on this expedition to discover kind of and explore the west coast of the United States, what is now the United States and Canada. So it's there's something pure and, you know, just spirited about it, you know, that maybe war stories lack.
Yeah, sure. No, that makes sense. There's a lot more levity, even though they are ripe with their own traumas and tragedies, but there is a levity of spirit to those stories, certainly.
Yeah.
So let's see, I think we only have time to get to probably one more question. But I'm curious about this too. How do you make sure that you're representing a diversity of viewpoints in history? Do you consult with experts from a variety of backgrounds and have them read your work before publication? Or because you do, I mean, I think you are a very thoughtful historian when it comes to that, but what are the steps that you need to take to make sure that happens?
Well, I don't know. I mean, you know, we can always do better. We can always go further in that. And I think there's definitely been a movement towards, you know, just as there has been in academia and in Hollywood and every other aspect of life, this notion of like, it's only the white guys whose stories have been told. It's only the victors whose stories have been told. We need to do a better job of understanding multiple points of view. And, you know, it's always often the male version of events that we don't hear from the women. We don't hear from the slaves and the stories about the South. We don't hear perhaps about the Polynesian point of view in stories about the South Seas. So yeah, I'm trying to bring in as much of the scholarship that's been done. I mean, there is kind of in a golden age of scholarship having to do with Polynesia because of DNA research, mm-hmm. and because of linguistic research. We're learning a lot more about what amazing navigators they were and how much back and forth traveling over many thousands of miles the Polynesians were doing between what we now call Tahiti and New Zealand, Easter Island, Hawaii, and so forth. So I do try to bring as much of that in as possible. The other thing is, you know, there's all these kind of expert constituencies within a book, like who will call you out on mistakes that you've made. Like what I've learned is you can make any kind of mistake in a book, a factual error, and you'll be forgiven. But if it has anything to do with guns, any kind of martial, I mean, any kind of a ballistic mistake, and oh my God, we can't believe anything this author has to say, because it's automatic when it's clearly semi-automatic, or, you know, 33, you know, 30, it's not the 30 caliber, and it's not, you know, I call it a 30-06 or something like that. You know, it's like, it happens. You do make these mistakes and these people come for you. They, you know, and the other category, almost as bad, is nautical. And, you know, like you call it a sprit and it's a spar, or, you know, it's like some little piece of the boat, you know. Mm-hmm. So I do send my raw manuscript out to a lot of experts to try to correct any kind of stupid glaring error like that that I could commit, because I'm not an expert in any of those fields. I'm kind of a generalist. So that's important and enjoyable. And they save my ass. I mean, those people come in with, like, you know, great, you know, 11th hour saves that make the book at least not as embarrassing as it might otherwise be.
For sure. Yeah, that's what a good editor's for. I think we're out of time, unfortunately. I can't believe it, because there's just so much more that I want to ask you about. But I'm really looking forward to reading your Captain Cook story when it's finished. I hope that it sounds like you're well on your way to having some really solid work completed. And I hope that the rest of the residency goes extremely well for you with the time that you have left here. And I look forward to hearing more from you. It's been great to talk to you. And I also look forward to, if you ever write a women's story, that would be amazing. So,
any story you might have along those lines, it's a glaring omission in my body of work, is that I have some amazing, in fairness, you know, female characters in my books, but, you know, the primary subject matter has been altogether too macho male. So we got to do something about that.
Let's do something about that. Okay, cool. Well, thank you again for being with us tonight and taking this time to chat with our audience. It's been a great pleasure of mine to speak with you, and I know my dad will be jealous.
Thank you. Appreciate it. This has been fun. Enjoyed it.
Thank you.